Good afternoon, everyone. And Jennifer, thanks for taking the session immediately after lunch. That's the toughest. So we've got a little bit of buffer here. So I think I'll, to begin, I'll just use a little bit of logistics in terms of, I know we're running late by 20 minutes. So we'll try and keep it, keep within our time limits, which was 1 hour, so maybe 45 minutes is a better time to look at. I think we should end on time, at least at the event level, we should end on time. So the format would be that maybe I can just sort of open the issue and set the context, and then invite the panelists here to share their views, their experiences on measuring and utilizing, implementing whatever, the happiness quotient, the concept of happiness quotient in organizations. So I think if I go by my personal experience of the last, and I think it's more pronounced in the last 6-7 years, where this element of happiness at workplace has started playing a much bigger role than it used to when we'd started our careers. And we didn't have so many concepts. I don't know what we missed out on, but we didn't know about work-life balance and happiness and all those things. So I think we never felt that anything was wrong because we didn't even know that something like that existed. So now things are different. And we're looking at, in my company itself, we have recently, we've added the fifth generation coming into the workplace. So I think that adds a lot of, not uncertainty, but a lot of challenges in the way that happiness can be handled at the workplace. So the first question obviously is, what is happiness? And I think for the purpose of this discussion, we'll restrict it to not happiness at the soul level, but happiness at the field level, right? So it's about how people feel at the workplace, how people react, how motivated they are, how committed they are, and so on and so forth. And what are organizations trying to do about that? So that's one bit. The fact that a lot of generations are working. There are two other G's that come into picture. One is geography. So any organization that is sort of spread out over not only different parts of India. So and I know this for sure, for a fact, that the culture between a Delhi office and a Chennai office is very different, and the things that you would do to make people happy are very different. So you can't have one size fits all. You have to look at, and therefore, different strokes for different folks. You need to be cognizant of the things which will impact the happiness in different cultural contexts. The third G obviously is the gender bit, which is again, you're trying to, and I think the uphill task is to keep the women happy at the workplace exactly as at home. So you're looking at a wide variety of, let's say, a spread out demographic population which you are trying to make happy. You don't know what's going to who is going to get happy with what, so you try a lot of different things, and that I think is the biggest challenge. The second challenge that comes is, what do you do with that assessment? So you try different things. You do your pulse surveys and your ESs and all of that, and you try to figure out what is the happiness quotient right now, and for whom is it low, and so on and so forth. But how do you put that data to use? I think that's something that we'd like to talk about in this panel as well, as to what are people doing to figure out how happy people are, and how are they putting that data to use at their workplace in order to increase the overall happiness quotient in that organization. So any order, you want to go alphabetically or something?
I'm fine. Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Ajay. Thank you so much, first of all, restricting us to the domain. I think what's really important is, since morning we've been hearing about how to be happy. We've been also hearing about what are the ways in which we could be happy. How we can, so we heard things from the delight expert who talked about the six things. Great. I think all of that was great for all of us. But the real question is this: how do I operationalize happiness at workplace? That's the real question. Is there something which can help me create my action agenda in terms of these 10 things? If I do, I would increase the happiness at workplace. Right? So that's the key question. But I come to a more relevant question here, which may make me kicked out of this room, and I'm happy with it. The real question is, does happiness lead to performance, or the performance leads to happiness? How many of you believe that happiness leads to performance? Okay, look at the hands. Okay. How many of you believe that performance leads to happiness? Chicken or the egg, right? Okay. Sorry? Combination. That's the easiest one. That's the easiest one. But really speaking, when you are creating strategies for the organization as HR professionals or the CEOs of the organization, we really have to focus and focus on what actions can I take to ensure that I'm spreading happiness in the workplace, right? One of the things that I wrote in one of my articles recently was about how the culture at Uber ensured that its CEO and the founder had to move out of the organization as the founder and the CEO. And you know about the entire story, right? It was the indifferent attitude towards women. At a particular point in time, there were 25% of population which was female, which dropped to about 3% over a period of time at an organization which we all admire, Uber, right? And the CEO founder had to leave the job because there was indifference towards women employees. Right? So let me narrow down to what can I do. So my belief is, we can go ahead with the combination, but my belief is that performance leads to happiness at the workplace. I'm restricting my answer to the workplace, otherwise we can go to Himalayas and be happy. That's not the thing that we are trying to address here. So if I'm at the workplace as head of HR, as the CEO of my organization, the big question for me is, how can I make my employees happy? And the question takes me back to, how can I make them perform and achieve what they are there to do? Right? And what can I do to make people perform? I think there was a huge amount of knowledge shared since morning. Things like, you have to offer right resources and tools. So that's the action agenda. A lot of time, the first thing, so I landed in one of the largest organizations in the globe. For 3 months, I didn't know what was my role. I knew the designation, and I tried to anchor all my actions through that designation. I didn't know what I was supposed to do. Great organization, all is well, but I was not happy. Why? Because the clear expectations were not there. The first thing, the basics have to be right. Can I make my people aware and clear about what they are here to do? Am I giving them enough resources and tools through which they can achieve what they want to achieve? Because I have the potential as an employee to deliver the task for which you have hired me. You have not hired me not to work. Yeah? You have not hired me not to work. But if you have recruited me through a very structured and top-class process, I have the potential to perform. But if you don't give me the tools, I don't perform. And if I don't perform, I will lose my tempo. So you have to ensure as an organization, you need to provide me enough environment. You talk about boss-employee relationship. You talk about enough resources. You talk about culture. All of that has to work together at making people perform. So here is an example. If I give my employees a family ticket to a movie, is that a good tool or not as far as performance is concerned? What do you think? If I give a film ticket, a movie ticket to my employees that go and watch the movie with your family, is that a good tool to increase happiness, to increase performance? Is that or not?
Maybe. Maybe.
Link to performance, link to happiness. Two things. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so that's a welfare scheme. That's a welfare scheme, good, fine. You give it to even that person who is completely disengaged in the organization, not performing, he would be very happy or she would be very happy with it. But would it result into performance? And here we are discussing how we can improve performance of our people. And which is where I'm tying the entire piece back to, we have to make our people perform. Do whatever you want to do, but remember that as the leaders in the organization, you have to make sure that you perform. And someone in the audience asked in the last session, HR, let me tell you, HR is just the custodian. HR does not drive a lot of actions which come from HR. It is driven by business. HR becomes the face. Remember this. I've been in HR, so I know this. And now I'm on the business side myself, and I know this piece. So with that, I think, sorry?
Thanks for saying that and believing that. That's something that you miss all the time. And interestingly, you know, HR becomes the function of HR. It's not, you know, which belongs, you know, to all of us. And, you know, we are responsible for the human resources within the organization. I'm so glad to hear it from somebody, you know, from the business side of it. Well, very interesting. Have I just jumped in, or you know?
You were perfectly fine.
All right.
Yeah, go ahead.
You know, so
thank you.
So for me, when Mukund came in, you know, just a couple of weeks back to our office, and he spoke about, you know, it's my maiden, you know, event, and I'm going ahead with a happy workplace conclave, you know, something really resonated. And I was, you know, all of 2 months old in my organization. I've spent most of my 20 years career in the manufacturing industry and hospitality. Real estate is new, is kind of compared to the experience, you know, that I've had with manufacturing and hospitality is just about less than 2 years. But the reason I decided to take up this opportunity with M3M was because I really did see a purpose, you know, that came straight, you know, from the promoters, and, you know, the value which they saw in driving somebody to drive human resources for them, you know, the value and respect which they have for people who are running the organization for them. So while I had a couple of other opportunities while I was taking this call, you know, for me, and I say this very openly in my organization, because I say it was a rather unusual call, because this is a, you know, still an industry, as we all know, still maturing up, a very challenging work environment yet. But I told myself, well, you know, I'm seeing that purpose, I'm seeing the involvement, the support, you know, so let me just go for it. And, and you know, from the smallest of things in terms of, you know, Jennifer, you said it, you know, in terms of, you know, make every person believe, you know, that the person matters. You know, so whether it's the person who's serving you tea or somebody who's driving you to work, or it's your, you know, projects person who's, you know, meeting some very challenging timelines, or, you know, sales guy who's, you know, being, you know, got these stretched targets to achieve. Everybody's making, you know, their contribution, you know, to make the business or the organization effective. And valuing that, you know, that your job matters, and making one believe that your job matters. I think that's something that, you know, in a very, you know, in a very new and a very fast growing environment, we are ensuring. So, you know, one part of it is obviously, you know, putting your systems and practices. So we are all of about 7 years old as an organization, and, you know, the organization has done, you know, well for itself in terms of having achieved the targets that it had set for itself. You know, real estate, about a seven-year cycle, it's the first cycle has gone well for the organization, and the, you know, we are really preparing ourselves for the next phase of growth, and you know, so we are sort of re-looking at our, you know, business, the business model, and, you know, the kind of people that we need to be driving us, you know, professionally. But, you know, the small things, so yes, you know, while I have drawn out the HR plan and the HR agenda, one knows, you know, all of those criticals, you know, you need your systems and processes in place. But I think while all of it is happening, you know, the small things in terms of making your people valued. So, you know, the chairman, you know, came up, we've got a new project which is coming up, and he says, you know, 450 employees yet in the organization. I'm going, you know, I would like to, you know, as a token of my respect for everybody who has been a part of this organization from the start, like, you know, from 7 years ago, even if they're not a part of this organization, I'd like to invite them and plant a tree in their name. And, you know, this new development will have a tree planted with each employee's name, you know, something that I'd like to, it's just my way of thanking every single person who's been a part of, you know, my organization, you know, or, you know, one of our offices that was our, you know, very special office for about 7 years, you know, became the site for a new project, and it had to come down because, you know, the excavation had started. And, you know, so, you know, suddenly there was this, we need to do a Thanksgiving, you know, for this particular office because we grew, you know, this is where we grew from scratch, and, you know, we just can't, you know, it just cannot be excavated without calling in those people who are not even part of the organization now, but hey, you know, so and so, you know, you dug up the place, you created this office, you know, the guy who brought in the first numbers or the profit numbers, you know, calling, so we actually invited all of those people, you know, to the organization, thanking them. So all I'm trying to say is that, and from my side, I think these are, you know, these are ways in which the organization can make its feel people special, who are currently part of the organization, who have been part of the organization at some point, but very genuinely trying to do all of these things. You know, so let's say, yes, there is a DNA, you know, within the organization of, you know, dreaming big and, you know, obviously it's not just about dreaming, but, you know, you've got to continuously be working on your breakthrough strategies and, you know, to be taking it along and, you know, fairly a risky process at times because, you know, you want to achieve a lot and, you know, there are specialists, obviously, you know, who are supporting in all of this journey. But what are we doing, you know, from the people perspective, you know, making our people valued? So just a few things, you know, that came to my mind just as we started out. And would you want to take it forward?
First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for having me here. This is a slightly different experience for me. And again, a pleasure to catch up with Ajay here. He's been my senior in college. We go back a very long time. We were together in Hindu college good 25, 30 years back. So a pleasure being on the stage with him after a long gap. So a little bit about myself before I start off. My name is Pravas Pandey. I work for the Indian Railways. And I'm a civil servant. And I'm part of the Indian Railway Personnel Service, which is the only specialized HR dealing service in the Government of India. So now coming back to the railways, now railways, as you will know, is one of the largest employers in the world, currently ranked the third largest employer. We are currently talking about 13.5 lakh employees. So it's a very myriad experience of working with a wide different range of people. So if you want to talk about happiness at the workplace, and when you're talking about these kind of figures, so it takes on a totally different perspective and a different outlook altogether. So you have to deal with people who are semi-literate, people who have actually joined service on basis of an affidavit saying their age. They can't even sign their name. And at the other end of the spectrum, you have people who have passed out from the top institutes of the country, highly educated, highly exposed. So happiness at the workplace, I would say, would take on a completely different meaning for these different kind of people. So I think in this context particularly, that one size fits all would probably not work. But then of course, agreeing here with what Masroor was saying, that performance and happiness definitely very much linked together. I would definitely say that a happy employee is a performing employee. And as somebody out there was pointing out, the converse is also equally true. But then again, like I was saying, happiness takes on a totally different hue for the person at one end of the spectrum. If you're talking about a semi-skilled or an unskilled employee who is what we call a khalasi on the railways, now that person is not so much concerned about these little tidbits about maybe the movie ticket example was given or something like that. These things don't really impact him so much. But then he would be more bothered about something very basic. Maybe it could be housing, insurance, health cover, But then I suppose this would be much more relevant in the case of large organizations, and also more relevant in the case of governmental organizations where these things are much more taken for granted. May not be that much applicable to the corporate sector. But still, that is a totally different perspective. I thought it would be pointed out. Then again, something like health cover. Now, anybody who is working with the government, working with the railways, is assured of complete health cover for self and family while in service and after retirement. Now, that itself is a very big, if you actually see it in terms, in monetary terms, it's a massive cost to the government, massive cost to the organization, but a very big motivational tool and a contributor to the happiness factor. So things like this really make a difference. I guess, yeah.
Any thoughts from the audience? Any? Oh, lots of them. Okay. So proximity. Yeah. Do we have a mic on? Yeah.
So Mansoor, this one is to your point where we were linking performance. Like you spoke about an almost linear sort of a relationship between performance and happiness. The thought that I would like to like you to elaborate upon is that performance is certainly an input that makes you happy. So if you perform, you are happy. But it's just an input because you need other factors to sort of work towards making you happy, like the fairness with which your performance is evaluated, the rewards that come alongside. So today you might be performing because of something as basic as your own value system. But if those other factors, associated factors are not there, how sustainable is that performance? Because you'll never reach that stage of happiness.
So true. Oh, sorry, what's your good name?
Anurag.
Anurag, thank you so much for raising this, and which reinforces what I said. What I mean to say is performance doesn't come just because of one or two things. It's a combination of things, which means you have to provide conducive environment to the employee to perform, right? Right from boss to employee relationship, right sort of processes in the system. If I'm not clear about how to do this task, I wouldn't do that. Or even if I do this in the best possible manner as per my thinking, I may still get the rebuke simply because I've not done this the way it should have been done. So do I have the right sort of capabilities that help me perform or not, right? If I perform, because the question really is, if I go ahead and make people happy as an organization, I'm not sure that I'm guaranteeing performance. I want to catch hold of performance as an organization. Excuse me if I'm sounding too materialistic. But the point here is, as an organization, I want to make every one of us perform. If I am in a social sector, still there are performance indicators. I want to win brownies on that. I want to really perform on all those indicators. And how can I perform? I can only perform because I have got enough ammunition with me. Is my company providing that piece to me or not? If I, as the HR leader or the company's leader, the business leader, go ahead and say, make everyone happy, you know what actions would come. Therefore, I want to delink it there. So when I picked up a contract with one of the leading law firms in the country, I spoke to the founder, and here was her first thing to me. Masroor, how can we make people more happy? I said, okay, that's good. And I said, what have you been doing so far? You know, we go out for a dinner as a team. We do all, I said, these are great things. These are great things, but I have not heard anything which helps your people perform. And if you don't let your people perform, there could be 1,000 things that you need to do to let them perform. And if you don't do all those things, people might be happy for that moment because they like the chicken. But eventually, they will go back and do the soul searching. What did I do? What kind of impact did I make? Now, just to go a little deeper into that, my achievement imagination would be different from yours, probably. If I'm just 0 years of experience. For me, the achievement is I did the first form really well. But for you, if you have been there in the system for 25 years, you would really like to achieve something else. So as an organization, I have to really see what are the buckets in my organization, what each of the buckets wants to achieve. So for example, the younger lot would be really after the rewards, incentives, because they want to save money, they want to get married, right? They want to buy flat cars, et cetera, et cetera. But after a point, it moves on. After a point, you would like to contribute back to the society. Is my company providing that opportunity to you or not to perform that piece, to achieve that success? And that is where I'm linking it back to happiness. Otherwise, I will have one kerosene for everyone. It wouldn't work that way. That's my take on this. Thank you.
So I think I quite a bit disagree with the performance and success, but I have a story that supports Mansoor's point of view. So this is a case study which is taught in either Harvard or Stanford, one of the two. So there's a bunch of students who are sitting in the class, and they have a case study that describes an organization. And it's an organization that's based out of Chicago. It's built in the worst part of Chicago, the most dangerous part. It's got no lighting, it's squalid conditions, it's got no hygiene, they provide nothing. So just, I mean, visualize, I can go on and on, but it's the worst kind of organization that you would think that existed. And the students are asked as to what do they think the attrition rate is. And the students, obviously, they respond that, you know, 200%, 500%, no one would stay there, why would anyone want to work, and so on. And then they invite the owner of that organization. So this organization is about 70-odd people. And he shares with them that for the last 20 years, not a single person has left. And everyone's surprised. But the fact is that, and that's what I was saying in the beginning, and that's what I think he also mentioned, that as you move on, life stations, there are different things which are important. Now, these were the people who were handpicked for their obsession with money, and only money. So the owner was paying them double of what any other guy would pay them in the market for their skill set and their whatever. And he knew that this is their driver, this is what will keep them happy, this is what will keep them motivated. So I'll spend my money on nothing else except the best of equipment, which is what you were saying, the resources and tools. And so they were happy because they knew what needs to be done. They were happy because they had stark clarity about what are the conditions that they'll operate in. And there was no dissonance in their head. So I think overall it boils down to the fact that we need to identify that if we are throwing a party for 500 people and we say I'll give you the best pizza in the world with an Italian, you know, a chef flown in from Italy and so on and so forth. Now out of those 500, at least 250 will not like pizza as a whatever, you know, as a food item. So you can't make everyone happy by giving the best of one thing to everyone. And that's why you need to have these, you know, a buffet, as if you may, which will hit home with a small percentage of people, but as a commodity, it'll hit home to everyone. You know, so I think that's the main, this thing that, you know, performance, some people are very happy with performance, but performance, I think I just add a little caveat that performing to the best of their ability. And obviously the attempt is to increase their ability as well, because you can't have it, you know, again, that dissonance thing that you expect this and he's only equipped for this. That obviously is going to get you nowhere. So. And just my two pennies.
My question or my observation is that whatever we give as rewards for performance, sooner or later come to become the norm. And whatever is the incentive, today's incentive becomes tomorrow's norm. And tomorrow, you know, it is an unending spiral of increasing expectations. So where does it end? So can we really call it a performance bonus, or continuously we are increasing the bar in that?
Are you addressing it to anyone in particular?
No, the panel in general. Anybody who can take up the answer?
Any takers? I haven't told him to shut up.
No, that's an interesting one. I think that's something that all, you know, all of us as HR professionals, you know, we are facing it at some point or the other. And I think within my organization particularly, you know, we are really we've come to a point, you know, where we are saying that, you know, because the nature of the business is such that, you know, every organization will be finding their, you know, key functions. Or so let's say if projects and sales are my two key pillars, you know, who are running the show, very specifically, you know, so it's not just about what we are saying is the goal setting, you know, it's really those key performance metrics, identifying what are those metrics, and then, you know, tying up the targets so closely to the incentive that it becomes, even if it's a stretch, it becomes possible to achieve. I think that, and this is something that is so dynamic that, you know, you have to continuously, it depends also on the nature of the business. So, you know, continuously, you know, if it's a growing business, I think it becomes like a, you know, every half year exercise that, you know, you need to keep reviewing, you know, the targets that you set and, you know, the evaluations. But very right, you know, in terms of it must make sense at that point in time, and setting the bar high, but why not? You know, setting the bar high, you know, you're also kind of then extracting that performance out, and they're excited about delivering, achieving those targets and the incentives at the same time. So it's a very, very interesting one. You know, we are continuously kind of evolving, working, you know, towards what next. So in our setup, we are focusing specifically on, there will be a balanced scorecard, you know, for the organization, you know, which is, you know, targets flowing into the various functions, but certain functions, you know, how are we tying the reward incentives to the achievement of the targets and making the performance metrics very, very clear. So we've got certain experts currently within our organization who are actually helping us link up the two. So, but it's a very exciting, I mean, I think, especially if you're a growing organization, I think this, it needs to be, you know, it needs to be continuously addressed.
Ajay, that embargo is removed, so you can speak now.
I think just one thought, sir, on this. It's a very interesting piece. See, as an organization, if I want to retain top quality talent, what can I do? So the question is, can I attract the best talent? And can I keep that talent year on year? Or am I going to bleed them? The thing is, if I have great talent, don't just expect them to keep producing great stuff year after year, year after year, without creating stretching points for them. Right? Which means that we have to keep stretching these people. The more talented the people, they would need more stretch. So in the morning, a doctor was talking about the bell curve and the tension, the right tension, to give right sort of performance. We really have to see more talented people would move towards, you know, their bell curve would slightly different from, you know. So we really have to keep stretching people. And the stretching could be in the form of putting them into different roles, which actually gives them more exposure and builds potential leadership skills in them. And they clearly see that the organization is going to take care of me, and there are possible growth paths for me from here up to the top of the hierarchy in the organization. So that's my take on this.
Yeah, so just I think to rephrase that, so I think you want to say something?
I just wanted to respond to what sir had said, that basically I think, sir, you have assumed that the company's growth is on a common trajectory and a regular growth. Now, if you are linking the incentives to the growth of the company, I think automatically that situation which you are saying will probably never come, practically speaking. Because no company can be expected to be on a constant growth path forever. So automatically it will taper off.
I think, again, if I've understood the question correctly, and just to answer it in one small this thing, that number one, differentiation is the name of the game. You can't be socialist and give everyone everything and so on and so forth. You'll be completely outpriced from the market. So the rewards are linked in my mind to two things. One is the ability of the individual, and second is the capability or the or the will of the organization to pay. So you'll be stupid if you pay more than the market, and you'll lose people, you'll lose good people if you pay lesser than the market. So that is the balance that the HR function tries to maintain, and it's, you know, within the population that it controls, that I'm not overpaying, I'm not underpaying, and the guys that I want to keep, which is what he was talking about. So the guys at this end of the bell curve, or this end, whichever way you look at it, those are the guys for whom this question will not apply. Because at a macro level, the SNW percentage impact of keeping 10% people happy is not enough to sort of demolish the firm. But if you do that with everyone, then obviously you're totally, you know, outpriced, and competition will just eat you up. So I think it's that difference, the balance between differentiation and whatever that sort of answers that. We're running out of time.
Yes, we are.
I'm late, I think.
So, but if you want to continue, please.
No. So I think there were two more questions which I don't know whether we have time for. I saw one and I see one over there.
About, if we can make it quick, yeah.
So one last question, guys, you choose. Which one is it? Whoever raised their hands first, I guess.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
So I'm new to the HR space, and please pardon my novice question if it is. The point is, you very well politicized so that performance, give them the tools and then let them perform. My question is, happiness as defined until now is a relative context. And when Jaspreet ma'am was here, she gave happiness vibes while she was seated beside me. So the question is for you too, is like, how do you place happiness? You're saying, like, it's, you know, in the WhatsApp messages that we get, when Steve Jobs, I don't know whether this quote is by him or not, that if you want to make someone happy, go sell ice cream. And as you said, if you want to make someone happy, rather go to Himalaya. But the point is, where do you place happiness in your organization? Is it the engine? Is it the first or the second bogey? Or is it the last one? When you've given the tools and say you've measured the performance, where do you place happiness?
Manish, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so...
Yeah, thanks for the organization. We have a government representation in front of us. So my question is, because government is a very strong workforce, this is a corporate gathering where corporates are doing various things like happy workplace, engagement, employee engagement, and various lots of the things. Because human beings are also working in the government, how government is engaging, as far as you know, the employees and all these things?
Actually, that's not a very easy question to answer. That I don't think any macro level measures are being taken as such. At least I'm not aware of any. But then at the office level, at the organization, as in the company level, departmental level, a lot of people are doing things like this. But then they are mostly individual initiatives, so as to say. I don't think as of now government is taking any major steps to work for employee happiness or their motivation or something like that.
Yeah, but just a quick thought on this. Hello. Yeah. So fortunately, I've been able to work with multiple government organizations. And what I've realized, each organization, all central government, the bucket that I'm talking about, they are potentially going to have all the similar kind of schemes for their employees, right? But I can clearly see the difference between the approaches of people in one organization to the other, to the extent that I can see how energetically they are walking. You can sense that. It's because of the, not because of the social welfare schemes. We've been discussing about this. After a point, they become norm. But are we helping them to perform? I'm coming back to the same point. If I'm not, I'm lost. I will be very happy retiring at 60 with all the perks and benefits of the organization without really being as productive as I could have been. So offer what will help your employees perform. Happiness will come. And I'm really not bothered about what happens after those 10 hours for now. Because
the audience would really like to stretch us to go, what happens at home? I'm least bothered, to be very honest. Because then my tools and techniques, my interventions would differ. And I would dilute my impact. I don't want to do that. Let me first focus on this. We see what happens next on the other side of the life.